Welcome to Take That With You with Follow Along Damaris, sponsored by NTTA. I am here at the desk alone. No, it's not everybody's wish of me doing my own podcast. Mark Followell is joining us from Cleveland, where the Mavericks are in the midst of a four-game road trip. I was with him yesterday in Indiana, but I'm going playing some hopscotch between radio and TV. I am doing TV tomorrow and then back to radio as I fly to Toronto Wednesday and then back here for our first WFAA game Friday on TV. So a lot of traveling, but Mark is traveling with the team. And how are you doing, Mr. Followell?
Well, I'm great. Speaking of Channel 8, I happen to see that Pete Delkus earlier today on social media had the 14-day forecast out, the great WFAA Channel 8 meteorologist. And on Friday's forecast, there was a little graphic on there about the Mavs being on Channel 8 on WFAA on Friday night. So
6:30 Friday night. Check it out. There won't be a pregame show. We'll roll right into it. I'm not sure if we're going to do something during the sportscast with Joe, but then Dana and I will have halftime and whatever postgame we can cobble together. But it's great to have so much of the Metroplex being able to check out the first of 10 games. And if you're in Waco, the NBC affiliate will have those games. And we also have some Spanish language broadcasts. I believe are on what
channel? Unimas Channel 49. Okay. Unimas Channel 49. So, yeah, it's a real thrill to be able to bring Mavericks basketball to all 2.7 million homes in the Dallas-Fort Worth designated market area, be it in English or Spanish, on over-the-air TV. And it's also a thrill not only to be able to work with WFAA for those English TV broadcasts and those 10 Spanish broadcasts with Televisa Univision and those games being on Channel 49. But of course, it's also a thrill, Brian, to be able to work with the good folks at NTTA who are faithful and longtime sponsors of Take That With You. You can score an official Mavs toll tag. Not only does it keep the Mavericks front and center on your windshield, but it cuts your toll bill in half. The colors are sweet, too, so get yours for just $19.99 at getmytolltag.com. Small sticker, big savings.
Thanks to everybody who checked out our trade deadline recap pod a couple weeks ago. We obviously took last week off of the All-Star game, but I think it was record numbers for us on the video stream. So keep listening, keep watching. Get your merchandise, your T-shirt. That's really all we have at TeePublic, T-E-E Public, and search Take That With You. But the big news of the day, and Mark shouted this out at the Indiana locker room, at the Indiana media room, across the room. He had to show me his brand new acquisition, something I've been pushing for some time. Show our viewers. He is now in the world of blue, the iPhone, ladies and gentlemen.
My text messages don't show up green anymore. They show up blue now. You know,
I used to do thumbs up instead of writing out okay just to make you mad because I knew on the Androids that it would put the message again and say that I liked it.
It didn't make me mad for the record. I honestly didn't understand that at first. I didn't realize that that's what that was. And then, you know, as the years went along and my wife liked a lot of my text messages and I saw the same thing would happen. And then I kind of finally figured that out.
So you're now an iPhone family.
Yeah. We're an iPhone family with my little iPhone 14. So here we go.
Are you having some remorse? Are you liking it? Are you finally realizing what all the hype is about?
I always knew what the hype was about. It's just, I also knew that changing phones, especially when you're changing from an Android to an iPhone, is a big life change. And learning things and transferring over apps and passwords and all those sorts of things. So there's been a lot of resetting passwords and trying to remember what they are and all that sort of business. But it's all good, man. Life is good. And, you know, it's thumbs. It's, you know, literally thumbs up. I can now just hit a thumbs up and like a text message.
Well, maybe we'll get you to a Mac soon. But the other thing, and we're going to work on this, is we're going to get you some AirPods. Now you can use AirPods.
Yes, I have some.
You can ditch the airline headphones that you currently are using.
Yep, I do have AirPods.
The other big news, of course,
started using them some. Yep,
is that today is your birthday? Wow, I don't know if Studio 41 knew that, but yes, it is your birthday. 56.
Thank you.
Congratulations, you made it all the way to 56.
Okay, that's 53, actually.
Oh, I'm sorry, 53. But, yeah. Okay.
So you know what the big birthday tradition is, Brian, and that is as soon as we get done here, I'll be going to the workout room. You can't do a 53-minute Peloton class, but I'll try to do like a 45-minute Peloton class and then some sort of cool-down ride, because there's always a workout, whether it's a run, whether it's an elliptical, whether it's a Peloton, to match the number of minutes and years. So,
wow.
A 53-minute workout is coming here whenever we get done recording the podcast and I head to the gym here at the hotel in Cleveland.
Well, I was disappointed. I just got added to the TV portion of the broadcast last week, so I thought we were going to be together and we could have gone out and shared a brown drink, but I hope you have some fun plans for tonight in Cleveland.
I do. Yeah, we have Coop and Brad Townsend and I have dinner reservations, and so that's my exciting night.
Wow,
so,
that is a... Yep. To be a fly on the wall in those conversations. All the world will be figured
out. You never know. You never know.
Can't get a word in edgewise with that crew. But well, happy birthday. Sorry I can't share with
Thanks.
You in person, but we'll share a drink after the next home game.
I love that. That's a great idea.
And hopefully you make it through all 53 minutes of the workout. But
I will. Don't worry about me.
Let's talk Mavs, because they came out of the break strong against Phoenix, and that was a national TV-only game, so you and I weren't on the call, but we were able to watch it, and this was a really good blueprint of how the Mavs want to play down this home stretch.
Yeah, the win by 10 over Phoenix was their seventh straight victory, which equaled a win streak they had last year. Those are the longest winning streaks that the Mavericks have had post championship season, Brian, with a seven-game winning streak. And it really was, the essence of what I think this Mavs team at its best can look like, and that is Luka and Kyrie, of course, being the center of what they do on the offensive end of the floor. Luka combined for 70 points in that game, 41 out of Luka, 29 from Kyrie. They had moments where they played off each other well. They had moments where one individual was able to carry the workload on the offensive end of the floor. And while I would say that I guess you would probably want a couple of guys to have some bigger numbers from the players around Luka and Kyrie, I do think at that particular game, Brian, you had some very timely contributions from other players. I know Hardaway only had 12, but he had a couple of important baskets. Green had 9, but he had some important baskets, some important hustle plays. PJ Washington had 12 points in that game. Some key baskets, some key hustle plays, some key defensive contributions. Kleba had a couple of shots in the fourth quarter on a night. He only had 7 points, but the couple of those baskets mattered in the fourth quarter of the game. So that's what I really liked about that whole performance across the board for the Mavs, and to weather an early big punch from Phoenix and to climb right back into the game on a couple of different occasions.
Yeah, and you mentioned the Lukai combination. They also played really well together last night. We'll get into that game in a bit, but going into last night's game, when they're on the court together, they were a 121 offensive rating. Now that, you can't sit there and say, well, then that would be best in the league, because not every team gets to play with their two stars all the time. If every team got to play that like that, then their ratings would be higher too. So it's not apples to apples, but it does give you an idea of how effective the team is when those two are on the court together. An interesting note that I found, well, I'll get to that later, but seeing the synergy between Luka and Kyrie, you're seeing them play off of each other more. You're seeing that Spain pick and roll. So, the whole issue, remember last year I talked about it over and over. I wanted to see them play off each other, and the word was, well, the defenses are just switching that. Well, when you can do a Spain pick and roll and bring a third person in, then that brings a big into the equation in how you run that lineup. It's kind of a double pick and roll, and that's what loosens up a lot of that, getting the right matchups that you want to get. You saw more of that happening in that Phoenix game. You saw, as you said, the load being able to take off Luka, so he's not playing 43 minutes a night. And some of the other contributors, PJ Washington, and I know we're going to get into him a little bit more in depth later, and I'm glad we're doing that. But defensively, I thought he really did a good job on Durant. A great job on Durant, frankly.
Yeah. I mean, look, he's getting a lot of tough matchups. Kuzma against Washington, first game, Shai Gilgeous-Alexander with Oklahoma City. And, he is more than handling his own on the defensive end of the floor. And I think your point is valid, Brian, about the fact that you can't just look at the offensive rating whenever Luka and Kyrie are on the floor and say, well, look at what they would be if, you know, because right. you could do that with any team. But I do think you can look at this. You know, number one, they're 10-3. Now, one of those games was a win against Phoenix. One was a loss last night. But they're 10-3 when Luka and Kyrie combine for 60-plus points. That's one thing about the importance of these two guys. And the other thing is, last night, even with the loss, which we'll delve into a little bit here in a minute, they're 19-11 in the 30 games now that they played together this year. So I think that's important to note as well, that you know, why we don't want to make too much about the offensive rating when the two are on the floor. The bottom line is, you know, the name of the game is wins and losses, and they're winning essentially 63% of their games whenever Luka and Kyrie play together this year, 19-11 in 30 games, and that's a pace. If you sustain that over the course of the season, then that puts you around being a 50-win squad. So I think that's really positive.
Especially when you look at where we were a year ago when everybody was kind of wringing their hands nationally about the fact that the two of them didn't have a great record when they were on the court together. By the way, I just want everybody to know that the headline there on the lower third, as they say in the TV business, eclipsing the Suns. Mark is a huge eclipse guy, and he cannot wait to see this total eclipse. Oh, you'll be happy to know.
Because we are in totality on April the 8th at 1:42 p.m. Central Time in Dallas.
Yeah, we were just talking about our schedule for the rest of the year of when we're going to come in and record these, and it was noted that we can't do it around 1 o'clock, which we sometimes do, because you're going to have your little nerd glasses on staring into the sky.
You better believe I will be watching that eclipse. You know, we leave for Charlotte that day at 3 o'clock Central Time, but there will be time to see the totality of the eclipse and then still get to the airport.
The dogs are going to go crazy.
1:42 Central Daylight Time, Monday, April the 8th, is the time at the beginning of the approximately 3 minutes of totality. Because, I mean, this is no kidding for those of you who are watching and maybe don't know this or you don't live in the Metroplex. In Dallas-Fort Worth, along with another swath through Central and North Texas and Southwest Texas, we will be in the path of totality where it is a total eclipse. And trust me, I am spending every day praying that that's not a cloudy day.
Oh, that'll just kill you.
I will cry. I will probably shed tears if that happens to you.
Well, the other thing, as the Mavs eclipsed the Suns last week in that TNT game, it showed their versatility. This was one of the things we talked about in our trade deadline recap, in terms of you have a deep team, you have a versatile team that can toggle between playing in different ways. They went small at times when Nurkic was not in the game. They were able to play effectively. And frankly, Nurkic played pretty well. I thought it was interesting that Vogel decided, that's how the Suns play a lot, mainly when they close games and play most of their games with Durant at the five and try to spread the floor a little bit. Nurkic was pretty effective, but when they went small, we were able to match that and play small. And when you play small, you can switch better, and that's a better defense for us. But they also played big with Maxey and Gafford, or Maxey and Lively. And you heard Luka say after that game, you know, he really liked them playing that big, and that helps the defense, it helps the rim protection, it helps the rebounding, and all that thing. So this team can play small, they can play big. These are just things that they couldn't do roster-wise before the trade or in years past. Even in the Western Conference Finals runs, you kind of had, you know, certain plug-and-play pieces, whether it was offense, defense, but the size issue that our buddy Itzhak Franco had commented on all year, you know, was solved a lot by what we were able to do there as well.
It's probably a pretty fair second guess about Vogel playing smaller in that game, because Nurkic was good. Nurkic was effective, and going away from that, I mean, the Mavs were better when they were the team playing small ball compared to Phoenix in that game.
And then last night, Sunday night, taking that win streak into Indiana and old nemesis Rick Carlisle, you're playing a team that had the second best offensive rating going into that game and didn't disappoint. And the main takeaway from this is when you're playing a team that's effective offensively and likes to push the pace the way they do, you can't make mental errors, because you're just going to fall behind because of this, the relentless approach that team has. If you had told me that Siakam and Halliburton were going to combine for 29 points, I would have taken that. But Miles Turner really had a huge game, and that was part of the difference in this one.
Yeah, he had a season-high 33 points. You're seeing some highlights if you're watching on YouTube right now. And, you know, I thought some of the performance of what Miles Turner did last night reflected a couple of things. Number one, to your point, the Mavs did make some errors. They had some unforced turnovers, some bad turnovers. They put a very good transition team, a team that likes to run, put them in the open court. That's problem number one. I also thought there were some other times that, you know, the Mavericks just didn't seem as tied together defensively as they have over the course of their seven-game winning streak that came to an end last night. The great Chuck Cooperstein told me last night, he probably mentioned this on the broadcast that you were doing with him on 97.1 on the Freak, on the Mavs radio flagship station. That the Mavericks were holding teams to an average of 11 points below their season average during the seven-game winning streak. And obviously Indiana scored, you know, way more than their season average. They averaged 124. They scored 133 last night. And some of the open threes, some of the fairly uncontested drives to the basket that Miles Turner got last night, some of the open mid-range jump shots that he was taking and making last night, I thought were all indicative of, you know, that was just some slippage on the defensive end of the floor relative to what we've seen lately, Brian.
And there are some communication issues. They're trying some different things now. Sean Sweeney has gone back to kind of doing some defense. And he started the season on the offensive side. He's back on the defensive side. They're starting this kind of one rotate thing where they want to keep their big close to the rim. And so you're seeing, you know, that big go out when there's a pick and roll, but then come back and two players need to go back and rotate up to the three-point line so the big can rim protect and rebound and do all the things you want your bigs to do. There was some miscommunication as they're learning that new scheme. You know, the defensive rating, and I was told by, you know, a member of the organization, you know, keep track of the defensive rating since the trade. That's what they're doing internally. That's kind of where they want to see. It's not really fair to say, well, this is what they are overall for the season because it's a different team. And since the trade, they are fifth with a 106.7 defensive rating.
And that's what taken a pretty significant hit last night,
right,
too.
They were number one during the winning streak since the winning streak began. And going into the Phoenix game, they were 4 points better per 100 possessions with Lively on the floor, which is kind of this model with Gafford and Lively of having that rim-protecting big. That's why they want to have that. And, of course, you don't lose anything when you have Maxey in there at the five either. So that just shows you how effective having that kind of player is in there. But when you're playing that kind of game, and you mentioned it, you know, there were some costly turnovers, even on fast break opportunities. There were costly turnovers that immediately turned into points on the other end. Little bit of sloppy play. There were also a lot of kind of ineffective shots being taken, kind of those long contested twos, which are just, you know, not only the nemesis of analytics, but just common sense shows you those are tough shots. And again, when you're giving away possessions in that way, and then the team's running the other way, you know, as I pull out my box score from last night, you know, you lost the fast break battle 22-7, you know, and that really hurts you, Lair, right now. You know,
Kyrie, and by the way, Brian, I think Jason Kidd agreed with you in terms of his post game comments. You know, he brought up some things about shot selection, and I think some of that, you know, he pointed to the fourth quarter. Recall that Kyrie led a run by Dallas where he scored the first 9 points for the Mavs in the fourth quarter. And that brought Dallas back to within 4 points. And then a big credit to Indiana's bench. Ben Shepherd had the best game of his career last night, literally 15 points. And he had a couple of key three-pointers as they reestablished a lead in that game. Obi Toppin played well in that stretch. Also, Ben Mathurin, you know, they did a lot of damage. I mean, Indiana's got the top scoring bench, and their bench did a lot of damage in reasserting control of the game after Kyrie led them on that run that got them back to within 4 points. And then to your point, there were some questionable possessions after that from a shot selection standpoint. And I think, you know, Jason Kidd even addressed that in his postgame comments.
Well, he basically said, get the ball back in Kyrie's hands. You know, it's fourth quarter Kyrie. You know, we need to get the ball back in his hands to do something. You know, 24 points off turnovers. Again, those turnovers were ugly. And so those turned into opportunities. You mentioned the bench scoring was 42-29. You know, this was a game, you mentioned, now the Mavericks are 10-3 when Lukai scored 60. They scored 62 of the 111 points, but weren't able to take that over the finish line. You look at the rebounding. They lost the rebounding battle by 8. We know that 7 is kind of that magic number that you want to stay within 7. You know, they were doing well in the first half, and then it just went south. You mentioned the play of the bench and those units. You know, it's interesting. Rick goes long stretches where he doesn't have Turner, Siakam, or Halliburton in the game, and the Mavs weren't able to make any hay during those minutes, which was really frustrating because of people like Shepard who were hitting those threes. And lastly, you know, you're talking about the assist numbers where Indiana had 38 assists on 52 made baskets. What does that mean? They're moving that ball, right? The Mavericks, 15 assists on 41 made baskets. A lot of ISO ball, a lot of clunky play. Yeah. Not the lowest assists that the Mavericks have had in a game this season. So
yeah, that's right. And Harp said on our broadcast last night, Brian, that he felt like he brought up independently of looking at stats in the third quarter of the game that the offense was stagnant. The ball wasn't moving enough from the Mavericks' perspective, that is. And, you know, obviously, as you pointed out, the final numbers will show that that was a night where there was a real lack of ball movement because of only 15 assists on 41 made baskets. That's a very, very low assist percentage.
And look, Indiana's a great team. They're obviously well coached. Rick knows what he wants to do against, you know, defensively and offensively against the Mavericks. You just came off a long winning streak. Again, the trend lines are in the positive direction, but I don't think a game like that is a bad thing to have, you know, come in here and say, okay, we all have been really happy since the trade, but let's have a film session. Let's have an off day kind of chat. I don't know if they're practicing today or not, but
they're they watch film. They watch film longer than they expected to before they left to go to practice.
Well, that doesn't surprise me. And I think that's a good thing that starting this very important road trip against, you know, frankly, three tough opponents. We'll get into that later.
And Brian, real quick, just to follow up on that, I thought Kyrie had some very good comments last night as well that, you know, said there's a lot of really positive things being said about the Mavericks right now nationally. And he said this is a really good time for this team to lock in and block out the outside noise and don't listen to too many of the things that are being said about them right now. You know, I think we all fall into this trap and it's very, very dangerous. I'm glad that they just had a 7-game win streak and that's really good. Of course, the other team is getting paid and trying to, and so the Mavs lose last night. But you're not as good or bad as your last game. And so, yes, things were pointing in a good direction there for a while. That all of those good vibes aren't negated by what happened last night, you know, but it wasn't a very good performance last night. But so I think it's good that Kyrie is saying what he's saying. And also I think it's good for all of us when we think about our analysis, whether it's us, whether it's anybody else that's involved in radio or TV analysis, or whether it's bloggers or other podcasters or whatever. You're not as good or bad as your last game. And you know, it's easy to drift into that sort of football style analysis when there's a lot fewer games. But, you know, the good and bad, both of what we've seen in two games, essentially out of the All-Star break, should be a good reminder that, you know, you're again, I know I've said it many times, but you're just quite simply not as good or bad as your last game.
And that's good leadership from Kyrie, veteran leadership. Guy's been there, done that. And that's a good voice to have in the locker room. So, having said all that, let's take a bigger picture approach. My latest D Magazine article came out Thursday, right before the Suns game. And basically, it was a look at, okay, we've made the roster moves we're going to make. You know, now what? What are the next 25 games? What's the goal of the Mavs and Jason Kidd over the next 25 games? I always look at things from a front office perspective because that's what I did. And the issue is really from a front office perspective, in terms of roster machinations, you kind of have what you have. Now, I did talk to some people last night. They still are scouring the buyout market, whether it's players that are out there now or whether players that still could become available before March 1st. So, you know, there is a possibility to add someone with that roster spot. But let's be real.
And real quick, Brian, because this gets asked every year, and as a matter of fact, I saw it floating around asking Brad Townsend online today to something that he said that corroborates your reporting, by the way, about the Mavs are certainly going to continue to scour the buyout market. You don't have to sign anybody by the 1st of March. The March 1st deadline is the player in question has to be off of the other roster by March 1st. You can sign somebody eligible for the playoffs up until the last day of the regular season.
It used to be that way.
Yeah, the date that matters is this. You have to be bought out and clear waivers by the 1st of March. And then that's the only thing that impacts playoff eligibility. Again, you can sign players as long as they're not on a team on March 1st. You can sign players all the way up until the last day of the regular season. Yeah. And they'll be eligible for the playoffs.
And that's a great clarification because, you know, listen, the reality of the inside basketball is that teams are having discussions with agents and going, hey, you know, we really like your guy. I think we can, you know, give him a role here. And that'll up his value in the summer, and maybe it's a better position than the team he's in. So, you know, take a haircut on your buyout or whatever, and we'll do something here. So those are the talks that are going to happen over the next week. Now, the reality is that buyout guys usually don't make significant impacts, but again, you have the spot and it's there.
Sure.
But what are these next 25 games look like? What is Jason Kidd's job over these games, and where do you want to get? Again, it's the laboratory. There's a practice today. That's great to hear. There aren't going to be a lot of practices going forward, especially in March and April. People get tired and you're in the home stretch, which means your laboratory is the games. And you're going to see Jason Kidd working through rotations, working through schemes, working through fits, finding the proper roles for each player. And one of the most important ones, and I got to give you kudos again to your pregame question to Jason Kidd last night, which was, you know, one of the most important things you have to do down this home stretch, I believe that was your question, was, you know, finding each person's role, communicating to them that role in a way that is receptive and the player buys into it.
That's really important. What brought up that answer, Brian, was, and I didn't necessarily expect him to answer it this way, but you know, now that you've had a chance to, you know, to make your trades and you have essentially your team, what is the essence of what you're looking for the players that make up the team around Luka and Kyrie? I mean, so much of what Jason and for that matter, Nico Harrison have said over the course of the last 10 months since last season ended, and everybody said Luka and Kyrie will work. Now our goal is to put the right pieces around them. And so with the roster overhaul that's gone on, my question was, what's the essence of what you need out of these guys? And rather than get into a lot of specifics, the thing he went to your point, was we have to get these guys to understand what their roles are, define roles for them, and they accept the roles that we define for them. And you see on the bottom of the screen there, find your best rotations, define roles. And of course, do all of this. And I know that Jason, you brought this up, Brian. Jason has said, you know, we need patience. But of course, the reality is that there isn't a lot of time for patience because the standings are very compact. You can win a game or two and go up. You can lose a game and fall down two or three spots. So you've got to do all of this and balance that with winning games too.
Yeah, role buy-in is important. If you go back to last summer and kind of the autopsy, a lot of the chatter was that you know, there wasn't a lot of role acceptance and definition and all of that. So that's really important. And, you know, you want to find what the right fits are. What are the right fits around Kyrie when he's in there without Luka? What are the right kinds of players you want around him? Do you want some playmakers, catch and shoot guys, defenders, et cetera, et cetera? What are the schemes that are going to work? These Spain pick and rolls, these new wrinkles that you can throw in to the game. You know, what do the rotations look like? You have a 10, 11-man rotation right now when everybody's healthy and Exum comes back and he's due back on this road trip. You know, the hope is that from what Jason Kidd has told us. So, you know, that's going to help things. But listen, you don't have an 11-man playoff rotation. So how does that tighten? Who do you start? Looks like Josh Green and Lively are continuing their roles with P.J. Washington. You need P.J. Washington to play that defense because, you know, Jones is now in the second unit. You now have solid defense across 48 minutes from Jones and P.J., but P.J.'s got to play that kind of defense to solidify that role at the four. Who closes? You know, all these different – do you play Gafford and Lively 48 minutes, or do you go small with Maxey sometimes at the five? Do you go bigger? All of those questions need to happen. And so – you know, that's what the next 25 games are going to give you. And, oh, by the way, you want to be healthy and playing at peak performance come mid-April. All of that has to happen at the same time.
So a lot on their plate, man. Yeah. No, you broke that down well, and there's a lot to figure out and a lot to sort through and to do all of that and then still continue to be in a position to put yourself up. Look, the bottom line is this. I've mentioned this on the radio show. I've mentioned this with you on the podcast before. We'll have a little more standings talk before the end of this podcast today. But this is not the Western Conference of the last couple of years where there was slippage and subpar records relative to the past got you some favorable playoff positions. I think you're going to have to be well into the 40s, high 40s to avoid the play-in tournament. You might even need to be a 50-win team, to be perfectly honest with you, to avoid the play-in tournament. You know, the East had a couple of good years. The East was above 500 against the West for the last 2 years, Brian. But this year, the West is winning. West teams are winning about 57% of their games, almost 57% of their games against the Eastern Conference when they play cross-conference games. So what does that mean? It means, you know, you've got to win games against the East, and it means that, you know, just especially 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, those records are going to be higher than they've been. The win totals are going to have to be higher than they've been in the last couple of years to secure those spots. So the pressure's on to do all of those things that you said to put yourself in the position to put the best foot forward, but you also have to be putting your best foot forward at the same time. You've got to do all these experiments, but also continue, you know, on all this analysis and tinkering and tweaking and still be able to win a lot of games.
Go to dmagazine.com/sports. You can read my article on there.
Really, really good article. Thank you. Really, really well done. Yeah. Very, very, very well done.
Interesting note on offense I looked at because of the Indiana matchup. Remember in the 1920 season, the Mavericks had the record for the highest offensive efficiency at 115.9.
Yeah.
Going into last night's game, that would have ranked 15th in the NBA. That's how much scoring has gotten more efficient. I just thought that was a little fun fact for you. But
I like fun facts.
Something interesting that Jason Kidd brought up last night was that this team and this squad has to get used to being the hunted. You know, you come in now as the new kids on the block. You're the seven-game win streak. You're feeling good about yourself. You're getting that national love. Again, this goes back to Kyrie's comments about, you know, listening to all that. But now you got a target on your back. Nobody's going to kind of slough in. You're going to get teams' best looks and best shots. And so we're going to see that going forward. And one of the, you know, we talked a lot about Gafford, but one of the big players in this deal and really an essential piece of this thing is PJ Washington and what he's able to do on both ends of the floor.
Well, in five games, you see on the screen, his offensive numbers are 8 points per game, 37% shooting. That's from the floor. That's not from the three-point line. The three-point numbers are 19%. I think it's 4 for 21, I believe, is what he's shooting on threes. He's really struggled in that regard. Now, on the defensive end of the floor, you see that note on the screen. He's holding opponents to under 41% when he is the primary defender. And the number was even better going into last night. That took a little bit of a bump the wrong way last night. It was like 38% going into last night's game. So, you know, to our point earlier, we've seen a lot of good things from the standpoint of Washington on the defensive end of the floor. But, Brian, I think he's adjusting on the offensive end. And we kicked this around on a recent radio postgame show. My perspective on it is PJ, for 5 years in his career, has played with a Charlotte team that no knock on them, but the numbers are what the numbers are. They haven't been competing other than one season for a playoff spot. They got into one of the play-in tournament spots 1 year when he was there, and they lost that game. And I do think that, and look, I've talked about this a lot over the years with Harp, who was traded from a very bad Dallas team to a New York Knicks team that was competing. And ultimately, that first year he got there, went to the NBA Finals and was within one game of winning a championship. And so I do think that there's an adjustment for him of, in the Charlotte situation, I can get shots in the offense and, you know, there isn't really a whole lot of expectation. I can take kind of, not maybe whatever shot I want, but there's a different level of pressure or lack thereof on the shot. And the type of shots that come to you when you're playing in a non-winning situation are just going to be different than the shots and the touches and the flow of the offense that's going to come to you when you're playing on a team that, you know, is going to hold itself accountable to be able to play at a high level and hopefully perform at a high level and do well this year. So I think that's an adjustment that he's got to go through right now.
Yeah, and it's not only that. Yes, you're playing in more high-pressure games, and you're not the primary guy anymore. You know, LaMelo obviously is there, but you're not getting a lot of plays run for you. You got to let the game come to you. You've got to find ways to be effective when you may not touch the ball as often. And that's why I think the curve for him, why I think his ceiling is higher than Gafford because of his talent and athleticism, but it's going to take a little longer for him to get into the flow of playing in this system with Luka and Kyrie, because as you said, it's just different. And there's the learning curve is the adjustment is just going to take a little while. The three-point shot isn't there yet. He's shown his first 2 years, he hit 43% from the corners. He has the ability to get there. It isn't there just yet. But what he's able to do offensively, and he's, you know, Nico said it in the introductory press conference, we're tasking you with being the starting lineup's guy that's guarding the best defender, best offensive player on the other end. His very first possession was against Shai Gilgeous-Alexander. You saw him be effective against Kevin Durant. You saw him play against Siakam last night and hold Siakam down quite a bit. That's his job. That's a key part of what he has to do. He has to spend a lot of energy on that end and then still be able to do things offensively, whether, and we saw it last night when he, you know, he's not just a catch and shoot guy. He can catch it there and make something happen, and not only make something happen for himself, but he had a nice little alley-oop there to get somebody else involved as well. So, you know, a lot of people are kind of pointing at the threes right now. I think that'll come around, but he's a really important piece of this thing because of the athleticism, you know, his youth, his energy, and what he's able to bring on the defensive side of the ball.
Versatility would be another word that I would throw in there. And I think, you know, I think we're on the same wavelength here in that he's doing a lot of the right things, making the unselfish plays on offense, playing very solid defense, as we noted again, according to the NBA.com player tracking data, when he's the primary defender through five games with the Mavs opponents, the opponents are shooting about 41% against him when he's the primary defender. So I think if you continue to do things the right way, things are going to sort themselves out in terms of your shot falling. And to your point, you know, very good corner three-point shooter early in his career, and overall three-point shooter for that matter. You know, he was up in the high 30s percentage-wise in the first two seasons of his career. This year has been the outlier that it's been down in the low 30s from a three-point percentage standpoint. But I think if he continues to play the right way and do the right things on both ends of the floor, the shots will start to fall. That's just, you know, the way it's going to work, I hope.
You had an interesting note on Luka that you wanted to share with us, because
yes,
I think you know that I am banging the Luka MVP drum. And if the Mavericks continue to climb the standings, then he's going to have to get his flowers there, because it's pretty ridiculous what he's able to do. I think even Rick Carlisle before the game called it, he's rewriting history.
Yes,
this
he did
year.
Say that.
And
yep.
So share with us an interesting nugget that I also found surprising.
Yeah, well, I don't know that this is going to help him in his MVP candidacy, which I agree with you. And I am at least starting to notice a little bit more of those flowers being given nationally. Where, you know, he's still behind Jokic and Shai Gilgeous-Alexander when you're talking MVP odds that the folks out in the desert are setting right now. But those odds are improving. So if you look at the Mavericks' all-time leading rebounding list, with the rebounds that Luka had, the nine that he had in the game against the Phoenix Suns on Thursday, and then he tacked on six more last night. But Thursday, he passed both Michael Finley and Mark Aguirre and moved in one game from seventh to fifth. So your all-time leading rebounders in Mavs history. If you're watching on the great Mavs Studio 41 feed on YouTube, you'll see the numbers. If you're listening, Dirk, 11,489. James Donaldson, 4,589. Sam Perkins, 3,767. Sean Bradley, 3,340. Luka, 3,255. 3,255 rebounds in his career. So now, Brian, Luka is a top five assist guy in Mavs history and should move another spot up the list before the year ends. He's now a top five rebound player in Mavs history. He's third with an arrow pointing up. He's about to move to two in Mavs history and made threes. He's not too far away from passing Jason Terry, maybe another couple of weeks worth of games before that happens. And sometime early next year, he's around 50 to 55 games away from this. He'll move into the top five in Mavs history in scoring. Michael Finley is the guy that he'll move past from six to five the next time that he makes a move up the Mavericks scoring charts. So, you know, as Harp says often on the broadcast, he's going to have a whole lot of the Maverick records, and the records and the list we'll be talking about before it's all said and done are related to the history of the league. But I thought that was a fun little note from the Mavs side of things.
Well, listen, you know, we get the pleasure of of broadcasting these games and calling them. And you know, we don't take it for granted. And I hope the nation starts coming around on what he's doing. And I think they will. There's some national TV games coming up for the Mavs that'll give be able to showcase what he's doing. But, Mark, it's not only your birthday, but it's that time of year. We got to start looking at the standings.
Yeah, we do. And really a lot right now. And look, the only thing that you can do, of course, is take care of your own business. But last night was especially
well,
a night.
Well, the Mavericks have to take care of their business. Our job is to fret over the standings.
Yeah, that is exactly right. Players on the floor, play the games and worry about those games. And let the take that with you guys and everybody else worry about the standings and the scores. And scoreboard watch, because last night, let's see, what happened last night? The Suns and the Lakers played and Phoenix won. Nice result from a Mavs perspective and that the Pelicans had a home game against the Chicago Bulls and lost. Also last night, let's see what else happened last night.
Pels.
Golden State lost to Denver.
Yep.
But then one thing that I thought was going to work out nicely for them, the Kings, and they went on the road and played the Clippers and won that game. So when you consider all of those results, here's how we look and see things this morning. The Mavs fall from 6-8. You know, this 5-6-7-8-9-10 race is really going to be something to watch. Utah and Houston have faded. They're not in the picture, it seems, anymore at 11-12. There's clear separation for the top four. I suppose it's possible someone from the lower echelon could still work their way back up if somebody up there stumbles,
but I don't feel like that's going to happen,
but you never know. 5-6-7-8-9-10 with the gap between 8, where Dallas is, and to 9-10, as you see, 3 and 3.5 games respectively between the Lakers and Warriors. 5-6-7-8, dude, is going to be a very malleable area of the standings that will be changing throughout the remaining 6-7 weeks of the season, until April the 14th.
Your goal is 5. You know, as you said, 4 is tough, but, you know, you never know. But listen, you steal a game on the road in the first round playoff series and you get home court back pretty easily that way. So your goal is 5. It's this 5-8. You know, you got the Lakers and the Warriors, depending on what day it is. Are they going up? Are they going down? Are they going sideways? All of that kind of thing. But the key thing is, what are the tiebreakers in these scenarios? Because, you know, it wasn't too many years ago where there was a three-way tie. The Mavericks were on the good end of that.
Yeah, with Portland and the Lakers. Seed. Yeah,
so
that's right.
I'm going to lean on you here to kind of break that down for us.
Okay. Well, I looked at the, you know, we're talking about 6 teams in the 5-10 race. So let's look at the 5 teams that are around them. Okay. So the Mavs and Pelicans have already played their 4-game season series. The home team won a game in each of those. You know, they split and they played 2 baseball series this year essentially. So they're 2-2. Right now, the Mavs have a better division record, and they one game in the loss.
So that's nip and tuck.
That is nip and tuck. And I believe that the Mavs have one with San Antonio and 2 with Houston. And I think that that's the same thing that the Pelicans have, as a matter of fact. So the Mavs just need to keep on winning their division games or hope that the Pelicans have a stumble in there. And if you end up tied in the division, then we go to conference record, which I believe right now the Mavs have the edge in that regard. And we'll examine that more closely if it requires us to do so. Mavs and Suns, 3-game season series, only 3 games. Mavs won it 2-1. That's
why that
Thursday game.
It was so important.
Massive game last Thursday.
Yes.
Kings, 0-2. Dallas has lost 2 home games against them this year. Both with a schedule maker kind of screwed them and played them on the second night of a back-to-back. The Mavs were on the second night. The Kings were not. When they play later this month in Sacramento, both teams will be on the second night of a back-to-back, Brian, when they play on Tuesday the 26th. The Mavs will be traveling from Utah. The Kings will have played a home game against Philadelphia the night before, and then they'll play each other again on Friday. That's a tall order to win 2 games in Sacramento, but that would be massive if the Mavs could do that, because not only does it bring the tiebreaker into the equation, but you just win 2 games and take 2 away from Sacramento, and we just saw in the standings that they're adjacent to each other in the standings right now. Lakers season series, 3 games, 2-1. That's all done and dusted. Mavericks have won that. And the Warriors, 1 win for the Mavs against Golden State, a road win earlier this year. Of course, then they were going to play them again in January, and that game was postponed after the tragic death of Warriors assistant coach Dejan Milojevic. And so that game has been rescheduled for later this year. So the Mavs and Warriors, the tiebreaker is still way up in the air with games at American Airlines Center on March 13th, at Chase Center in San Francisco on April 2nd. You'll be doing radio on that game. That will be a national TV exclusive. You'll be doing radio. And at American Airlines Center on Friday, April the 5th. So those are three circle the date games between the Mavs and Warriors for the rest of the year that will have impact on the standings in terms of just who wins and who loses, and then also impact on a potential tiebreaker scenario.
Yeah,
so
and the Warriors are playing better.
A lot of big games.
You know, we unfortunately didn't catch them when they were swooning. So we will have those are, you know, we'll keep updating that weekly and kind of keeping everybody abreast of what's going on.
The other thing too, Brian, real quick, is the Warriors, if you look at opponent winning percentage, they have one of the easiest schedules. The Suns have the hardest schedule in the NBA. If you look at opponent winning percentage based on that, the Warriors have one of the easiest schedules in the NBA based on opponent winning percentage. They did lose last night. They did lose to Denver. That helped, but that's something to bear in mind.
I don't hold a lot of stock into that stat, considering last year we had a really favorable schedule and it all went south. So just
didn't work out very well in that
regard. Play the games. This week, Cleveland has lost 3 of 5 after winning quite a few and being on a roll.
17 of 18, yeah. The Cavs won 17 of 18, Brian. Let me tell our viewers and listeners as it relates to the Cavaliers game tomorrow. Dante Exum will be listed as doubtful. He did practice today, and as you mentioned earlier in our updates, he's expected back on the trip, but it doesn't look like it's very likely to happen tomorrow. Now, we'll see what happens when the Mavs play a back-to-back on Wednesday when they're at Toronto. The Cavaliers are coming off a win yesterday over Washington. Donovan Mitchell has recently missed a couple of games that they lost, as a matter of fact, Brian, because he was sick. If you flash back to the game that the Mavs and Cavs played in December, they were very shorthanded. Garland was out. Mitchell was out. Evan Mobley was out. And Cleveland still came back and won that game. Caris LeVert had a big game. He had 29. George Niang at the time had a season high, was 16. And Jared Allen was huge. He had 24 points and 23 rebounds. Isaac Okoro had a season high of 22 in that game. So Cleveland's got some guys who can help and step up when they have injured players, and that happened back on December the 27th at American Airlines Center. But there's no injury factor going with Cleveland now. They're as far as the players that matter, they're a healthy team.
Allen had a great game, and you know they play big, so it may be a game where you see, you know, the Gafford-Kleba or Lively-Kleba combo to kind of toggle up and play big there. And then the odd back-to-back where you got to clear customs and go through to Toronto. It's a new-look Toronto team than what we've faced. You know, they're playing with R.J. Barrett and Emmanuel Quickley now. Mm-hmm. Obviously,
Bruce Brown.
Gary Trent, Bruce Brown. Still a scrappy team, although it's the easiest in this four-game road trip. That's going to be one, again, as a back-to-back. You know, maybe that's an Exum return. We'll see what happens there. That's tough. And then, obviously, we know what the Celtics are doing. That's just going to be an absolute knockdown, drag-out there. And then
a quick thought on that, Brian. The Celtics have been human at home lately. I know overall they're on a long winning streak, but they have lost 3 home games in the last few weeks. And remember that they started out something like 20-0 or 19-0 or 21-0 at home. Yeah. And then they lost to Denver. They had another stumble in there, and then they lost to a Laker team whenever LeBron and Anthony Davis didn't play. So they have been human at home as of late. And
you hope your depth can play there. They're top heavy. Their top six is great, but you hope your bench and your depth can be effective in that game.
And to something you brought up earlier, Brian, I would circle that from an MVP perspective, because that's on a big stage. That's going to be, in addition to our WFAA telecast, that's going to be a national TV broadcast as well. So that's going to be a real opportunity for Luka playing at Boston and Jason Tatum to maybe elevate his stature in the eyes of those that have votes for MVP. So that's something to look for on Friday night as well.
And then Sunday, an ABC game against the Sixers, obviously still without Joel Embiid. We just saw that kind of variation of that team when we played up there a couple of weeks ago. And then we'll be back with another episode. And obviously, keep in mind Friday, the first game on WFAA at 6:30. Mark Folliwell, I'm sure we'll have a special suit for that one.
You know me well. You know me well.
He's got that circled. He's got the rest of the his big plan. His big All-Star weekend was spent laying out his suits for the remainder of the year. So
that was my maniacal laugh. That you do know me well. So there will be something special for Friday night.
Well, everybody, give Mark a shout out for his birthday.
Thank you.
If he may even reply, just drunk off mezcal. By the way, I had a glass of mezcal in Florida over the break, and I tried it again because I was like, I'm just going to give this a real try, and it again tasted like battery acid. So I just...
Well, Brian, I had a lot of mezcal in Oaxaca during my All-Star break sabbatical in Huatulco and the Mexican state of Oaxaca, which is the home of mezcal production, and all of the mezcal that I had nightly with dinner on our various nights out with dinner for dinner, it was magnifique. Que rico. It was outstanding. Maybe we're just not getting you the right mezcals, Brian.
Yeah, maybe we need to try that. Well, we'll see you next week. Have a great trip out there. I'll see you in Toronto in a couple of days. And everybody, tell your friends to get on that YouTube channel, hit subscribe so you know exactly when these download. And if you're listening to us, do all the things you're supposed to do on Spotify and Apple Podcasts as well. Thanks for joining us.